And now, welcome Pini, and welcome Keith, and they will entertain you for the rest of the evening.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Pini Reznik from Container Solutions. I won't move too much. Right, so I'm going to talk about cloud-native applications. Just trying to give hints what it actually means. We are actually Container Solutions, part of cloud-native foundation itself, which is part of Linux Foundation. So I'm supposed to know, although you will see it's not exactly clear yet. So Container Solutions, we mostly located here in Amsterdam and doing a lot of stuff with containers, as you can understand from the name. So, and also I'm going to talk a bit about DevOps and my kind of current opinion about this. Can you hear me? Oh, I need to speak louder.
Louder.
Not very convenient for me, but fine. Right, so who knows about Docker? Very good. I'm not talking about Docker. So, who knows about Mesos? Good. Mantle? Good, okay, fine. So, normal crowd. So, about 2 years ago, I started talking about Docker, so actually, that's possibly the last time I'm talking about Docker. So, I was using this diagram to explain the history of software development. About 15, 20 years ago, we had monolithic applications. You don't need to read the text. These are like diagrams for blogs. So just focus on the visuals. So we had monolithic applications. We have some kind of middleware stack with operating system, databases, and whatever else, and monolithic software. Everything in one big chunk. And of course, we moved since then to something like this, some kind of virtual machines, and this kind of structures, some kind of web servers connected to databases, to some third-party libraries and all this stuff. So we have many more moving pieces and the number is growing. And we run on virtual machines and invented cloud since then. So today we are moving towards something we call now microservices, which is, I'm not going to explain what it means, like reason why. And we're trying to use clouds more effectively and run across multiple clouds and use reactive UIs and all kinds of these technologies that essentially their main point is that there are many, many more moving pieces in the system. So if in the first 20 years ago we had maybe, you can count on your hands, the number of moving pieces, machines and and applications. Let's say in the last 5 years we get to hundreds of servers, and today we get into thousands or tens of thousands. And when you get to tens of thousands, the whole scale changes. The way you work with stuff is essentially there is no way to work manually with any of it anymore. So basically there is this kind of tension between application speed and deployment speed and a number of moving pieces in the application itself and the infrastructure. So for example, if in this age you had a physical server with the operating system installed manually, it took you like half a day or something with all kind of troubles in the middle. And also if you want to install Oracle, it takes you half a day. So actually, if you take deployment of Oracle to 7 minutes, it's still half a day. It doesn't change dramatically the overall result. So that's why there is always this kind of breakthrough in the technology on one side, and then the other side catching up. And then again, there's like they are going together. So that's why today we see containers and microservices. They are kind of going together. So containers are a new technology that allows microservices to exist. All kind of people tried to do microservices 10 years ago. It wasn't possible because the speed of deploying virtual machine was too high for that. And of course, there will be something else. I don't know. You can guess. So that's the background. Now, if we talk about monoliths, then of course, the typical, actually, that's very optimistic for 20 years ago. Most of that was done manually, something like this. So, you know, this, I use this in, again, Docker presentations. Before containers, you know, you have this old ships without containers, you need to put stuff in manually, and it's difficult and labor intensive, and there is like this, the boss knows what to do and how to manage everyone, and they all feed the things in exactly the right way. That's how we've been treating our servers until very recently. So, okay, fine, this is not, but this is just the background. So the way we would like to show it is basically this is the application itself, the logic that you want to show to the user, your website, your online service, your whatever it is. It's supposed to be yellow, so I might say yellow at some point, but and then the red thing is the management around the application itself. So how much time it takes, how much effort in general it takes to deploy the underlying infrastructure, to manage it, ongoing management of this application. So in the age of monoliths, you had the monolithic application and monolithic management of those applications. So it might be even manual, right? Some people actually going somewhere and doing some things, like physically doing some deployments. Okay, so the next step, we move to this kind of client-server or multi-tier distributed applications. And in this environment, it's kind of side story about DevOps. DevOps appears in this somewhere in between, let's say, in between client server when you had 10, 20, 30 pieces running your infrastructure. When you started crossing 100, you have this a Dunbar number of 150. When you start losing the names of all the servers, then you are in trouble. So at that point, you need to group them and do all kind of automation things. So at that point, DevOps appears, basically saying, yeah, okay, you have 151 servers, you're in trouble, let's automate something. And that's because if you have requirements coming to a developer, he develops the code and packages it, you know, this story about DevOps throws over the wall and then it breaks all over. So DevOps suggests to put developers and operations in the same room to solve the problem, which is of course working for a while, because you know, people in the same room is better than same people in different rooms. It's obviously a good idea. But when you start crossing bigger numbers and you get into thousands, that also doesn't work, because they don't really communicate well. Even if you put them in the same room, they're like using different tools, speaking different languages, learn different degrees in university, they're really, really different people. Sysadmins and operations, even in the same room, they are not the same. So you have two choices. One is to let developers to learn everything about sysadmin, and sysadmins to learn everything about developers and create this kind of generic DevOps person. But then, of course, there is a limited amount of space in the head, so you lose something. Right. So you, I mean, if you learn something, you push out something else, on the average at least. So, what we're seeing is this kind of wall of confusion that was originally called in DevOps is not a bad thing. It's just in the wrong place. So essentially, what you want is a developer who writes a code and creates an application. You want it to go all the way to the cloud without any involvement of operations people. Not them in your room helping you to do it manually or semi-automatically, but actually fully automatically is part of normal development process. And operations people, they are still very useful because those clouds need to run somehow. And actually maintaining clouds is a difficult job. And typical developers can be aware about this a bit, but at some point it's a matter of specialization. Typically, over time you have more specialization, not less specialization. Not generic people, but specialized people. So DevOps is kind of intermediate solution. So, if we follow this non-DevOps, DevOps, DevOps or whatever other name, there are other names for this kind of idea. If you follow, you can see different tools changing. We started with Bash or manual, and then moving through, you know, typical DevOps tools. And today we are talking about containers and things around. And when you work with containers, if you want to work with 10,000 containers, there is absolutely no way to use Puppet. I mean, it just doesn't work. So you need something else. Now, so a bit about cloud native, that kind of coming in this age of containers. So when you say I want to use containers and I want to start 10,000 applications, you want to define those applications, containers and multiple microservices. You need to define those microservices somehow. You need to define standards, ways to deploy this, and generally define the ecosystem. So Linux Foundation is the governing body that creates collaboration projects like Cloud Native Compute Foundation, that basically their responsibility is to define those standards. So this is the goal of, you don't need to read this. Okay, I just highlighted some. Essentially, Cloud Native Compute Foundation is setting the goal for itself to define something that is distributed system, scaling to thousands, multi-tenant, container package, dynamically managed, microservices oriented, and easy. Right? That kind of defines the role of cloud native applications. Now, there is no specific standard yet. This foundation only started operating a couple of months ago. But the idea, this kind of general lot of text with just a bit of meaning, will actually take shape and become actually set of standards accepted by the industry. And of course, most of the vendors are in this foundation right now. Okay, so with container solutions, working with some of those vendors who are building tools around containers or microservices. So one of these tools, actually two of these tools are here. One is Manto and another is Shipt. So Manto is this hybrid cloud management system that basically runs on top of multiple clouds. It's currently built mainly with Mesos and a bunch of other tools integrated into it. And Shipt is a tool that is kind of continuous delivery pipeline to deliver microservices to Manto. I'm not going to talk too much about this, but while working on these projects, we've been exposed to a lot of things that are changing dramatically in the way you operate with your infrastructure and the way you build microservices. So basically, this is the actual part of the talk when I'm going to show those concepts and ideas that we've been experimenting with in the last year or so. So first, the main idea of this combination of Shipt and Manto is essentially get to the developer that translates his ideas to microservices, a bunch of microservices or a single one, and defines in the way those microservices, can test them locally, then define the policies for the managing these applications on the cloud, then deploy to the cloud, and then see what's happening, basically manage through these systems. So what we're trying to create is kind of native cycle that you would see in normal development. When you write a piece of code in Java, like a line of code, there is a well-defined standard procedure that you would go through to basically make this line of code available to the client. So what happens if you need to build microservices? Of course, very few people understand how to build microservices. A lot of us heard about this, but how actually do you start doing this? What kind of files you create? What kind of tools you are using? You know, all these questions basically, so this is what we are working now on. So I'll show you an example, which is not a real demo, but like a prototype. This is shipped. This is continuous delivery platform for microservices. I can do something more easily. So I can define the policies on high level, because we are working with developers and not sysadmins. You don't want to ask them to define exact number of CPUs and exact policies on the networking or exact IPs and stuff, because developers, they don't care about these things. They want stuff to run there somehow. Hopefully better than before. So you can define the budget and define some kind of high-level requirements on the infrastructure. And then you can combine your system based on services. So each one of these dots is not a container, but it's a fully functional service that might be actually more or less complex, and it's coming from some kind of central repository of services. So some people build those services and then store them somewhere, and you can just consume them. So in this case, first example is Elasticsearch, and of course it can be just one container or one instance of the Elasticsearch, or it can be complex cluster, or it can be very complex redundant cluster with 24/7 support or something like that. And of course you can pay for it. So you do a bunch of those services. Yeah, I'll do it quickly. Something like this. So then you can define policies on each one of the services, define the network connections between them, and define policies on those. Then you can say these two belong to this on-premise setup, right? So limit execution of those services to on-premise. You can limit execution of those to a certain cloud. And this, of course, you can imagine why would I do that, for all kind of regulatory reasons or performance reasons or price reasons and whatever. And of course, there is some kind of code behind it that we don't want to understand. So there's some magic happening. And during this magic, the system will go to the post, to the clouds and all kind of policy engines, and will try to understand what's available and create kind of multiple scenarios that may fit your needs. So basically, we'll give you multiple options for deployment. You can say, I want the fastest one, but the cheaper than that, and actually deploy it to the system. And then it becomes actual working system. So it's from architectural view, you move in the same tool, you move to execution, to maintenance view. And then you can add all kind of layers of information about this system. Okay, so that's the first demo. So this is kind of, these are kind of systems that we are trying to build. Basically, make creation and maintenance of these microservices, make them the same complex. Basically, they should reach the same level of easiness as you would have with a single application running in a single binary or something like that process. So those kind of applications we can define like this. So there is a bunch of actual applications or pieces of functionality, and there is a management which becomes more and more complex, like Puppet and then containers and then Mesos and all kind of 20 different tools all together. So at some point, actually, you may spend more time on deploying your application than actually building the application. And it is totally centralized, right? And this like central logic is getting out of the hand totally. So the next one is another. Another layer when you start with microservices. So, okay, you understand that this is not right, so what's next? And the next is a bit of decentralization. So a bit reduce the complexity of the central brain managing all the systems and start putting them locally, those pieces of brain locally. So we've been working on multiple Mesos frameworks. And Mesos frameworks are distributed systems running on top of distributed systems, and they hold distributed systems, and it's very difficult, right? I mean, it is really difficult. So there is a cluster, Mesos cluster, with a bunch of nodes, and all kind of clusters of Elasticsearch that holds like the framework clusters with scheduler and executors that define other clusters, and they need to collaborate between them and find each other. It's like difficult, right? So I'm just showing it to show off and like impress you with complexity. So recently or currently we are working with Joint on another project that basically, so it's called, yeah, probably something else, but for now autopilot pattern. So the idea is that you can put some of the logic inside the application itself and let it decide on its own what it actually going to be. So what you want to do is, the first example we did was with MySQL. It's intentionally to show that actually it can work with even stupid applications like MySQL. And I mean, in cloud world, it's obviously very, very important application. So the idea is that in addition to the MySQL itself, you put a small piece of logic that is responsible in making sure that this MySQL instance is functional. It knows, for example, when it starts, it looks around. If nothing is available, it becomes the master, the first master. The second one, when it starts, it looks around. It's using console for sharing the knowledge. And it looks in console, it says, ah, there is already master. Then I'll become replica. This is all happening without any central management. So basically, they're all doing it on their own, self-organizing into cluster of MySQL. So we actually, while working on those microservices, we built this tool called Mini Mesos. That's because those Mesos frameworks. Those Mesos frameworks are difficult to build because Mesos is difficult to maintain, install, set up, and install things in it. It's just a nightmare. So we built this tool that you can just quickly start your Mini Mesos cluster on your local machine and then do things with it. So I'm going to run this autopilot on Mini Mesos, not on real Mesos. Although it is a real Mesos running on my machine. So I'm starting in Mesos that currently includes Mesos itself, Marathon, console, with scope and some other stuff, something. So it takes something like 10-15 seconds. And we'll wait patiently. Yeah. So it's running. It means I can go to Mesos and I have two slaves running and I have Marathon. You don't really need to understand everything. I'll emphasize the important parts. And we have with scope. It's actually a nice tool that shows you all the containers in your environment easily, so you can, it's very useful to understand the what's happening in your cluster, basically. Oh, sorry. Yes, that wasn't not the intention. And the console. Right, so now I have Mesos cluster running. Now I can go to this and schedule my application to the to Marathon. So now I have my, so basically what I did, I just scheduled a single container, which is essentially standard MySQL container with a bit of logic, with additional wrapping, or additional image around that image. So now we can see it's running, and if I go to console, I can see that there is a MySQL primary key. It runs some health checks. Okay, now it's passing. So basically, the first container is running. You can see on this MySQL application, it has one container. And if you look on console, it basically registered itself as the master. Right. So now we have a single master MySQL. Now if you go back to Marathon and I say, let's scale this application to two containers. So now I just essentially start another similar container, right? So you will see it's staging, starting, and in a second or two, okay, it's running. Now if I'll go to console, yeah, it takes a few seconds until they all figure out what's going on. And yeah, okay, basically there are two instances now, and one, the second one became the replica. So whatever it means, it will take care of the configuration between them. So this all happened without any central logic. So absolutely no, like no one telling them what to become. They all do it on their own. So essentially what we are trying to do is, if you can see it, there are a bunch of way more moving pieces in your system, but each one includes a piece of managing logic on its own. So essentially, they will try to do some of the things on their own without asking for external help, but there is still quite a big central management system, like Mesos and things around. So this is moving towards more and more self-organization and self like complex adaptive systems and something like that. So essentially, I mean, software will become autonomous, more and more autonomous in all kinds of places. And the easiest way to see it is in cars. Of course, self-driving cars is a self-driving software with wheels, right? It's, so what's the future? Now, the future, way we see it is that this of course, there's the brain, the central brain is still, it's like human brain that managing every single cell in the body. It's like not very efficient, not cool. So there's some kind of organization to bigger entities, like tissues, organs, and whatever. So there are still embedded brains in each cell, and then they combine into bigger entities and then create local cells and then bigger and bigger and bigger. So think of this, like you have a Mesos, so running in Mesos and use it, like using Mesos, and it's all recursive and weird. So another part that we, as part of that sheep mantle combination, we were working on something like this. You need to scale your application and show, you see what happens, like I scale the application, and the this thing on the left is growing to represent the actual user resources. So while working on this, we figure out that actually it seems like a very simple thing to do. I just click three times and some cool things happening, and some doors are running or out. The problem is that it's actually, as simple as it sounds, it's very, very difficult to achieve with current tools. It's so scaling and actually scaling applications and understanding what's going on, based on not deciding what to do with them, is actually very non-trivial thing. So while working on this, we kind of reached the conclusion that those systems, with their scaling and behavior and cloud migration, all kind of other stuff, they're actually as complex as the software itself that's running on this infrastructure. And software itself, actually, we use programming languages to define it. So let's do that for infrastructure too. It's, at the end, it's programmable infrastructure. So what we want to create is something similar to normal development environment, when we have IDEs with code, actual programming language, with actual defining infrastructure, that we can, so we source, that we can package in some way. And I'm not talking about a single container, because Docker does it very well. But it's about the service, like that MySQL cluster or Elasticsearch cluster with a lot of containers all together with all kind of embedded logic like auto-scaling and all kind of other things and policies. So all this packaged as a single entity. And then you want to test it locally to make sure that it runs before you actually use it and store it somewhere in some kind of distribution place, and then translate it to some kind of possibly graphs or some kind of representation, and then deploy to any different number of clouds. So essentially, this whole process is the same as you would think with software. Like imagine, Microsoft Word. So yeah, you have a developer writing code in whatever, C++ or whatever they're using, and testing locally, packaging in some kind of executable, storing on the web, and then everyone can deploy it and use it. And then on top of that, we can also create all kind of additional logical plugins, like policies, or for example, before you deploy a container, let's check which cloud is less expensive and deploy to that one. So if before you take a container and schedule somewhere, you can go to some kind of external logic provider and check what are the current prices of the cloud, and then bring the right one, deploy to the right one. Yeah, sure. Right. Sorry. Before I show this, so this is the actual code that we use. This is a real system. It will be recording because it's a bit longer and a bit more difficult to show. But it's a prototype that we did, and we used Groovy as the easiest language to embed in running system. So essentially, this is a piece of Groovy code where we say something like, this is definition of my container. I want to start two of them. Basically, you know, very simple. And then at the end, it became reactive system, so everything is subscribe and do something. So we subscribe to events coming from the running system, and if we see that my container that I'm looking for is removed, then I'll start another one. So essentially, this piece is the piece that creates self-healing, right? And of course, you can extend it and you can do more complex self-healing. And another one is this one, which is very similar, but at the end it says, if the RAM is higher than 90%, then scale up. So essentially, these couple of lines create auto-scaling on resource use. What it actually means is that you can start creating your own pieces of code like that, and then put them in libraries and distribute, and then other people can use them, and then this way, if somebody creates code that defines auto-scaling, and everyone can use it. Same as in normal software development, right? So essentially, we're talking about orchestrating infrastructure in the way that we do with normal software. So I'm uploading this one of these files now. The self-healing one, I guess. To define the policies that I explained before, and then we have running. This is actually, the black dots are previous system that was already running there. So this is representing the distributed cluster, similar to Mesos, but with Manto. And this describes the actual use of resources and the limits on those resources. So now I, what did I do? I'm going to, all right, we are still waiting for this thing to start. So now we have a first red dot and the second red dot. So essentially we schedule, those two containers I showed in the beginning, they are running now. So now I'll go to just the CLI, and I'm going to kill one of the containers directly using Docker command. So there's nothing unusual here. This is one of the those red dots, essentially. And it's dead now. So coming back, you will see that one of them is disappearing. Yes, that one. So now the backend kind of is, so it recognizes that one of them, yeah, so it started self-healing. So it recognizes that there is an event that this one of the containers is gone. So let's do some self-healing. And after a while, we will see the red dot appears again, okay, on another machine. So this is the first part, and the second part is about auto-scaling. So again, I'm starting with uploading the code, which defines my service. And of course, it can define multiple types of containers. We're just using red dots for to show how cool it is, but otherwise, you can see where it goes. Okay, so again, we are waiting for the service to start. First one, and the second one. So now I'm doing simulation of load. And you see it recognizes simulated load. Of course, it's a proof of concept. So now it responds with creating additional one. It will of course check the available resources and do all the relevant stuff that it needs to do before the deployment, and at the end it will deploy another one somewhere. Yeah, that one. And it goes like this. Yeah, I can do more of those. So that's enough. And that's it. Questions? Yes.
Obviously, sometimes the set of requirements regarding RAM and CPU usage and that stuff. How would you, if you were to create a new service or an existing one, how would you define those standards or minimum requirements?
So, if I, in that Groovy file, there is actually very similar format as in normal, like Mesos or Docker. Yeah. So, you can also say how much resources to give to this service.
How would you come to that number? Do you use Pfizer, for example, or?
I mean, that's something that, yeah, so normally this is responsibility of a developer, right? You just need to know, and you try something, and if it crashes, then you give more, right? That's, in this kind of systems, you do something reasonable, and if, when you run out of resources, then it will scale on its own. So I would say that's the more reasonable approach. And then you define policies how far it can go on auto-scaling. So you basically give some kind of random number or whatever, reasonable number, And then from that point, it will just scale.
So you made this for Cisco. So what kind of customers do they have that are interested in these? Because I'm sort of, and I have the idea that most customers of Cisco are these enterprises who barely know what the word microservices means. Let alone that they are able to make them more.
Yeah. So if you wait until you have the market, then it's kind of too late, right, to start. So companies like Cisco, they are smart enough to invest into this before the market exists. So what you see right now is there is a lot of companies using software on clouds. They all want to do Docker, right? They don't understand what are the implications of this, but they try. Now, some smarter ones are already into schedulers and some other things. And as I show this, like, it's somewhere in the middle of my presentation, you get into schedulers. But there is something else coming. So most of the market will get into schedulers like Mesos and Kubernetes and this kind of stuff, maybe in a year, maybe in 2 years from now, and into this kind of advanced systems that live on their own, maybe more. I don't know. I don't know about the future.
I understand.
But you need to start building them now, or it will be too late, or somebody else will do it, right? So eventually, all big enterprises will go through different stages and get somewhere like this. Maybe not this exactly, but something similar, sometimes in the future.
And a follow-up question. At Ubuntu, they talk about system containers. That's where they made the LXDF. You think there is, in the future, there will be space for system containers? That these are sort of persistent containers which have long living processes?
Yeah, actually, some systems already doing this. We can, I think Rancher doing separation between system and normal containers. In CoreOS, there is like all kind of ways to do it. So yeah, it's happening. So you want to divide the infrastructure that is running your kind of hosting your containers and the containers themselves. So some companies doing separation like that.
Thank you.
So there is another platform that seems to be skipping the containerization part. It's Cloud Foundry, I guess. And how do you see that in the ecosystem and connected to using advanced logic to scale applications?
Yeah. So I know that Cloud Foundry also getting popular, and actually they are like all about containers now too. So they are fairly,
yeah, they are
fairly
also
much
towards.
So I think they have different approach, but even more than they have different kind of different crowd. They are targeting somehow. They are coming from this group of things like OpenStack and CloudStack and whatever, and somehow they could disconnect from them and take step forward. But originally Cloud Foundry was built for pre-container world, and now it's adopting itself. So, I mean, I don't know, it's just another tool. It's not exactly a scheduler, it's not exactly container management tool. Some people really like it. Actually, Trifor owned one of the companies that built parts of it in the past. So, yeah, I mean, yeah, just another tool. So I'm actually not extremely against Puppet per se. I'm just saying it's, they're also trying to do containers, but they just built for a different purpose. So it's too difficult to change the architecture in the way that it will actually work right. With Cloud Foundry, I just don't know enough about them to decide.
I am from ops background, so everything comes when the systems are running to operations perspective and you need to monitor the system. And even here, it can randomly create more number of containers, more number of instances out there. How do you cope up with the monitoring aspect of it?
Right, so actually we did quite extensive research on monitoring because essentially, when you move to containers, more and more containers here to the system, all kind of bad things start happening. So it's not just the orchestration, gets difficult, let's say, but also monitoring many, many other things. Essentially, today, let's say, this one. So essentially, in the past, you would put your monitoring below your system and collect the monitoring information from after the system is running from below, like you collect the results of the execution essentially and put all this system in some big Elasticsearch or some kind of thing, and based on that do analytics and then decide how to respond. So the problem is more pieces of running stuff you have, the more information you're dumping into your Elasticsearch, more connections you have, more overload, longer it takes. It's just difficult. At some point, it's just too difficult. So that's why in this system, you see there's clear connection into services. So for most of this information is irrelevant. You need to just drop it. And unless it's like in you have trace levels in software, you can collect more and less information. Normally, what you want to know if the entire service is healthy. So if, for example, you have Elasticsearch with 10 containers and one is dead, this is not a monitoring event, right? Not an alert. It's a normal execution. It will start another one, right? It's fine. So what you want to achieve is that each piece of this, like each one of them may die or I don't know, do something bad, but then on the service level, the service management understands if the entire service is healthy. If not, it will fix it if possible. If not, then it will go to central brain. And also the monitoring events will only go out of the service to the central system only if they are relevant for the central system. It's like, imagine ourselves, you have monitoring alerting system, pain and nerves, right? Only certain type of things going all the way to the brain. Most of the stuff we are doing is totally, will never reach the brain. Otherwise it will be overloaded.
So basically every part of the brain has some part of the monitoring embedded into it.
Basically this thing will take care of monitoring of all this thing. And the central one will only do whatever the lower level brain cannot do. So essentially you aggregate the information. So instead of dumping the instead of doing it from below, collecting all the information and trying to make sense, you essentially collect all the information all the time and then drop most of them immediately, most of it immediately, then choose the important one, aggregate it, and then pass up when needed. There are no tools like that at all available right now. All the tools they are trying to, what they are trying to do right now is to collect more information and do more complex analytics, right? Deeper analytics, different levels of, like, dig deeper, analyze more, and it works, but it just to a certain extent.
So what will happen to the DevOps role as it is now? Do you see it more becoming a sort of programming or sort of a program?
I think first, to be clear, what most of what I'm talking about is for the future. Right now, DevOps is absolutely winning the market, and companies are paying for it and want it. It's like agile, everyone wants it. That's how the world works. I think at some point you need more automation, and then it's like testing, right? So there was testing, there wasn't testing in 50s, and then in 60s they invented testing, dev separate discipline, and then the department grew and grew and grew, and then agile said, you know what, actually testers should be in development team. And today we have no testers at all. Many companies just, you know, developers to the testing. There is no need for that. So it's like, when it's a pain, you split it, then it grows, then the connection is the pain, then you merge it back. So DevOps will be merged back at some point.
So how far away from production this is all?
Which part of it?
Basic programming, the grooming part, like the specifying how your server should react to the given
state. It's not very cool. I mean, it can be built in probably months that it will be reasonably bored, but conceptually it's so beyond what people need right now that it's difficult to say when it actually will happen. Okay. Thank you.